Hello, a very good afternoon. Welcome to the Pulse on the Joy News channel on Multi TV. And coming up in the next 2 hours, industrial disputes at the Kotoka International Airport that could force grounding of domestic and international flights into the country. We'll bring you details and some analysis here on the show. Abu Ramadan and the Electoral Commission are back at the Supreme Court this afternoon as litigation over the voters register reaches the crucial stage. We'll be live at the court to bring you an update. And this man, Kojo Bonsu, known to have introduced several projects to transform the garden city of Kumasi into a modern one. Why are the people demanding his head or for his removal? We'll try to understand the politics of managing Kumasi today. We have the details of these stories and more in the next 2 hours. My name is Francis Avan. Grab that chair, sit down, and let's get started. And as always, your views and comments are welcome on this show. Look for us on social media at Joy News on TV on Facebook, at Joy News on Twitter. Drop your comments with the hashtag The Pulse. We'll be glad to share your thoughts with the rest of the world. My name is Francis Abban. It's a dispute that could end deadly. Today, staff at the Ghana Civil Aviation Authority, operators of the country's airports, have begun the partial withdrawal of services to demand the release of their lands encroached by several individuals, mainly politicians. The workers say they'll escalate the action by this Friday to include the cancellation of operations to international airlines. Spokesman for the workers, William Emwakun, has been speaking to my colleague Jennifer Kriamwa on the action.
The authority is working together with the Ministry of Transport, and we are liaising with the relevant government ministries, departments and agencies to have land released for the installation of the equipment. So we're on it.
Most of the action is internal. We want to put some little pressure on our management. We know they are doing well. They've written a couple of letters, but we want to still push them to do what they have to do. That is one. Then, if by Friday nothing has been done, we still don't have access to the land. We're going to ground local flights. It means there wouldn't be any flight within. No movement within Ghana, Accra, Kumasi, Accra, Tamale, Accra, Takoradi. There wouldn't be any movement. We're going to ground those movements.
And how long do you intend on carrying out such an action?
As long as possible, until we get access to the land. We don't want to wait until the equipment becomes totally down. You know, like the Director General said, GCA is always proactive. We've bought an equipment lying down over 600,000 euros, and we can't install it. Why did we buy the equipment? So we need to install it, and we're taking this action for those who can let us have access to the land, to do what they have to do.
It's our understanding that the land is not residential. It's actually designated for the airport, for civil authority. So why hasn't it not been released to you?
Yeah, exactly. So, the land has been the executive instrument that was, that gave the land to civil aviation. It's clear. We heard people are saying we don't have title to the land. Well, that is true, but the government took the land for civil aviation. We have the executive instrument. I have a paper in my hand that states clearly the purpose. They took the land for Department of Civil Aviation as a remote station. So the land belongs to us. How come the land has been taken? Well, to be sincere, we don't know. Because it's been there for quite a long time. We're using it as a remote receiving station for some time. We decommissioned our equipment for a period, and we are moving back to the land, and it's not available. And even aside that, every when you go to any country, civil aviations or for that matter, the airport has, reserved land for future development. So that land is not like we are not using it. It's there. We are using it now. We are supposed to use it now and for future development.
Did they give you any timelines at all?
For now, we don't have any timelines. That's why we are embarking on this action.
Okay, and after Friday, when you enforce the seizure of all local flights, what about international flights? Will your action then escalate or?
Exactly so. We're hoping that we'll get response. Even we are hoping that it will not get to Friday where we have to hold flights. But if nothing is done, we'll get there. And if after some period, we will meet and assess the situation and we can go international.
This equipment, if it's not installed within the period stipulated, what happens next to the airport?
Well, I think there is a misconception that has been created that our airspace is not safe. It's far from that. Everything is okay for now. Ghana's airspace is one of the safest. All the airlines will testify to that. What we do is we are being proactive. We don't wait until equipment are grounded. So when the equipment starts, we even have a period, the period that the equipment is supposed to go. Once that period reaches, we make plans. And once the equipment starts giving problems, you try to address the issue. So that's why, based on this, that's why we bought the equipment and we thought we were going to install it. Unfortunately, we met this problem. So if it's not installed, what is going to happen is the HF may not be working as expected. And for that matter, we may not be effectively provide the services that are needed. And see, one other thing is, I think they've talked about getting other land for us. Well, if we're able to get other lands, fine. But the issue is, these equipment were not purchased. You don't buy them off the shelf. They are manufactured for you. They take so many things into consideration, calibration and the rest. They go to the sites and the distances, and based on this, they manufacture the equipment. So it's site specific. So getting another land for us may not serve the purpose. That is why we are pressing very much that this land must be released.
So that's the spokesperson for the air traffic controllers speaking to Jennifer. And Jennifer joins me today. She spent a good measure of today at the airport trying to understand what the implications of this action would mean for aviation in the country today. Jennifer, good afternoon to you. We've already heard from those who are pushing for this action to be taken, but what's the situation at the airport now?
At the airport right now, things are very calm and steady. It seems the union workers have not enforced their threat to shut down operations at the domestic terminal, so operations are still going on right now. However, they are still really pressing for talks with management to ensure that the land is released by Friday, because after Friday, they will enforce their threat or promise to make sure that all operations at the domestic terminal will cease.
Okay. Now, for the passengers, those who come and board the domestic and international airlines, what has been your own response or their reaction to this announcement by the air traffic controllers?
Well, we've spoken to a couple of passengers and they've expressed worry that operations will be shut down at the domestic terminal. The international passengers as well, they're hoping that it will not reach that extreme. Here's one person that we spoke to on his view.
Going to be very, very worrying, because first of all, it's going to stall businesses, because people travel, actually we travel with airlines because we usually want to beat time, and so we want to get things done faster. So if this is going to happen, then it means that, and there's even going to be much pressure on the transport, let's say VIP and other road transport sectors. So I think that they should look at it and then resolve it faster.
So that's one passenger speaking to Jennifer on this matter. And is this the only reaction we got? Did you get the chance to speak to management? I'm talking about the Ghana Civil Aviation Authority and what you're doing about this. Because clearly, this will compromise aviation, that leg of transport in the country?
Well, I did get to speak to the Director General, that's Mr. Simon Alete, on this very issue. He was actually addressing a workshop, so I called him very quickly for his opinion on what management is doing to avert any such occurrence at the airport.
Working together with the Ministry of Transport, and we are liaising with the relevant government ministries, departments and agencies to have land released for the installation of the equipment. So we're on it.
Quite a brief response there, but they're saying that talks are underway to resolve the grievances. We'll find out from the air traffic controllers and their leadership. They've been able to reach us here in the studios. We'll go for a quick break. When we'll come back, we'll sit down and interrogate this action that they are taking today and whether or not this is the way to go to resolve this matter. We'll be back after this short break. Stay with us. Hey, welcome back to The Pulse on the Jory News Channel on Multi TV. And just before the break, we were talking about the Ghana Civil Aviation Authority and the strike by the staff asking for their lands, which have been encroached on, to be reverted back to them. Otherwise, they will withdraw their services fully for domestic and international flights that move out of the Kotoka International Airport and all the airports across the country. Let's interrogate this decision being taken by the workers today. William Amwako speaks for all the workers' associations under the GCA, as well as the main labor union. Mr. William Amwako, thank you, sir, for joining us.
Thank you,
this afternoon on the program.
Thank you.
We've already heard you state why you are on this action, but I need to ask you, have you thought about the implications of your actions on the general aviation sector for this country?
Yes, apparently we have actually reviewed the implications and we know the effects. But you see, if we don't take this action, we may never get back the land, and that implication will be worse. The implication of not installing those equipments can be worse than the current implication that we're likely to go through.
There's something that still beats my mind. How is it that the workers are more concerned about the lands that have been encroached on than the management?
Well, maybe management will be in a better position to answer that. But when workers realize that management was not doing enough, or for that matter, we've lost the land, and we were asking management to take it up, and all their effort was not yielding any result, workers decided to take the matter up.
So you're saying that your action is based on the fact that management has failed in getting the lands that you need to work?
Well, not fail per se, but because we're also aware that they've also tried their best to get the land back, but for some reason, they've not been able to achieve it. So we decided, because you see, one other thing is, we believe most of the management staff, one, may not be committed, two, some of them, few years, they will leave the system. The workers have more years to go.
Because what? They are politically appointed?
I won't say politically appointed. Maybe that would be a factor, but we are not even looking at that. We believe that the workers have more stake than them. We have more years to go. And for that matter, if anything goes wrong, we are going to be the people who are going to suffer much. Mm. So we need to take the necessary action to correct all those wrongs that has been.
You mentioned that management, you say management has done something about it, but it's not been enough.
Exactly.
Do you know what exactly they've done?
Well, we are aware that management has had a couple of meetings with the Ministry of Transport, as well as Lands Commission, and maybe other, powers. We are very much aware. So that's why we can confidently say that we know they have made effort. We're also aware that they've written some letters to the Lands Commission, but we are not receiving any results because we bought this equipment way back, over 8 months now, and nothing is being done.
Okay. Now, you've started this action. Who are you expecting to take action on this matter? Because clearly you're saying the management has not done enough on this.
We're expecting the Ministry of Transport, we're expecting the Lands Commission, and we're expecting the government as a whole to take a critical look at what we are asking for, and give the land back to us.
But the truth is, the encroachment you speak of did not start today. For the areas you speak of, the Adenta, the La Quintanan, the wireless areas, they've all been taken over years ago. Is it just because you've got new equipment that you need to install, and that's how come you suddenly realize that your lands have been encroached on?
No, that's not wholly true. The Langkwantanan land encroachment started recently. As a matter of fact, there were some few issues between GCA and the landowners. And government came in, and I think they realized that, oh, this prime land, very vast land is there, and that is where we have information that cabinet, the Adenta Municipal Assembly, and some few people met, and they made a proper land use. I mean, they came up with a land use plan. We even have a copy of the plan. But even within that, a portion was given to aviation. So at least we know that within that, we were given a portion. How come that portion is no more there for aviation? It's also another, matter that we are actually worried about. Mm. So it's not that the land was encroached long time. No, it was recently, and workers became aware when our engineers went to the site and they were chased out.
Chased out by who?
Chased out by, I would describe them as langers, but they said they were from the national security, which may not be true or may be true.
Mm.
So apparently, we're chased out by our engineers. We're chased out by those people. It is around that time that workers became aware that we really have a problem at the site.
Okay, if it's a question of lands that have been encroached on, you say it compromises your work.
Yeah.
Why should someone who is boarding a flight from Accra to Kumasi or Accra to London suffer as a result of your strike action?
Yeah, because we believe that when we mount this action, whoever is concerned or whoever has to take a decision for us to get the land, pressure will be mounted on them to release the land.
So you do not care who suffers as a result of it? Because you see, this is a matter that government needs to deal with. But the ones who use the service of aviation are not just government officials.
Yeah,
you're talking
that.
Major airlines and businesses that run solely on these services.
So they need to put pressure on government for government to act, because you know, in most of these things, there's what we term collateral damage. You know it's going to affect others, but you are left with no option. So we expect that people who are going to be affected will mount the pressure on the government, mount the pressure on land commission, because you see, the land was acquired for civil aviation. We'll show you the executive instruments, and for people to just take it just like that, and it's not like we are not using it. So if that can be done at any time, then it means we I don't know, but it's going to affect aviation. And what we are doing, let me just clarify, you see, the inability to install this equipment can even create more situation. These airlines may not be able to fly at time to come if this is the way we are going to manage.
How soon will that be? If the situation doesn't change, in how many months will we get to that point where the airlines cannot fly?
Well, I'm not saying we'll get to that point because we have enough.
I'm saying if there is no action, how soon is that possibility?
Well, currently, the HF equipment that we're using, its life has even been expired. It's over 15 years now. Normally, by 10 years' time, you should be able to replace them.
Mm.
We've gone beyond that. It's working okay, maybe with just some few problems. We've not encountered any major problem yet. But that is why aviation, like you said, is being proactive. And you need to install those equipment before this one gets, grounded or faulty. You know, those equipment can halt at any time. We have engineers who work on it several times, but, they are machines. So you bring in new ones, we bought it, with huge sums of money, very long time. Why is it not being installed? Just because some people want to use their land for their personal gains, we put in a commercial interest over aviation safety. We are not saying currently there's a threat, but there's a possibility if we don't do the right thing.
Okay. Now, for the domestic airlines and the international airlines that will be affected, is there not any way you can still push your demands without having those who use these services as critical services denied that opportunity?
For now, we're not even talking of international flights. For now, we're talking only of domestic flights. So our action is not going to affect international flights for now.
Even after Friday?
Yes, even after Friday. It's purely domestic. We've tried all our best. I think we've gone to the ministry, sat down with the minister. We've made several attempts to talk to chief of staff. You not even have the chance. We've even tried to talk to former president. Yeah, we know he has been one of the people who we know understand aviation. So we've made several attempts to even talk to him to kind of explain to these people, yet we've not even been granted the access to do that. And all the powers that be that we thought maybe can help, we have talked to them, Land Commission, so we left with no option.
Okay. Now, per the release you put out today, you said that the withdrawal of services will be gradual.
Yeah.
What have you taken away now as we speak?
For now, all that we're doing is internal. The internal is meant to put pressure on our management to, do what they were supposed to do. So most of the issues have to do with our drivers will not be working internally.
That's for today?
For today.
Tomorrow's a holiday, so clearly your action won't affect anything.
Exactly. Accounts are not releasing checks. So even if you are an external contractor and you have your checks to pick at GCA, you may not get it because they will not work on it. As well as travels by our directors and the executive, we're going to, hold all checks relating to those things for them to feel that the workers are not happy about the way this issue has been managed. Then we have the safety regulation who will not be doing the usual inspections. And when they fail to do those inspections, it also has safety implications. So these are some few things.
And these are being done at Kotoka, Kumasi, Tamale, and Takoradi.
Exactly.
Especially for Takoradi, the safety is big.
Yeah, for Takoradi, we don't have an issue because it's a military base. So okay. Almost all the staff there are military, so they are not affected.
Okay.
But because the flights will take off from Takoradi and come to Accra and vice versa, it's not going to happen.
All right. Yeah. Mr. Alko, thank you for your time. Let's just hope that for the actions that you're taking, there will be some response from government in getting back the lands which are required to do your job. Thank you for your time afternoon. Let's move on to another issue that's affecting virtually everybody in this country. I'm talking about the worsening power crisis. In the last 1 month alone, it's gotten to a head as the public outrage continues. More than 240 megawatts of power has been shed every single day, with many Ghanaians complaining about the impact on their lives. Officials have indicated that the lack of fuel has been the main reason for the shortfall in power supply. Some of these Ghanaians who are angry have been speaking to journalists about how this is affecting their lives.
Yesterday when I got home, I was told since morning we're having a light off. So it just came around 6. Yeah. So the power outage, yes. Although it's not that like the initial stage, but maybe you go off about 12 hours, some it goes off within an hour, it's back. So you don't know, you can't classify it as whether it is doomsday or no, not doomsday. But actually, we are experiencing that light out.
For the power outbreak, this morning when I was leaving home, it was even off whilst I was coming. And then yesterday night too, when I got home, where the lights were on and then all of a sudden it went off. So we even thought it's there. Prepaid, which has got finished, but we saw that it was a lighthouse. And we don't know. The government says they are solving it. They brought this huge, the thermal to do this thing, to solve it. But it's still ongoing. We don't know why. We don't know what they are doing about it. But we pray that they solve it so that we all be in ease. We even think that while the soldiers are there, we are on the same lines with them. So there being a military area, we are going to experience good electricity, this thing. But even them in the barracks, they also experience the same thing. They also experience the same thing over there. So I don't know, them being government institution, we thought that it could also affect us. We also have benefit. Benefit from it, but it's like, nowadays it's getting worse.
Oh, it's very bad, if I may say, very bad, because day in and day out, lights have been going on. Even the whole of yesterday, I had a light out the whole day. It was evening that it came. It's wet in the morning, it came later in the evening. It looks very stressful because sometimes you may be alone in the house and there's no power supply for you to entertain yourself with your telly or your gadgets in the house. So sometimes feel very boring.
It happens most often that I can't tell, but let's say out of a week, it happens about 4 times out of a week. So bad, I can't bear. In fact, we don't like it at all. It just comes and goes sometimes. It comes, goes on and off like that. And
what comes and goes?
The doom saw. Yeah, the lights just comes in, goes out like that, and it's a very bad thing. It destroys our appliances in the house too.
It's more complicated to keep food to normal practice in the hospital, but we will deal with that.
Yeah, I live at Adenta, House Sundown. That was last week. From Wednesday, we had a light out, and because of that, I have to wake up dawn to iron everything before I'll come to work. Minor works around that barbering shop and other things. Because of that, when you go there, they will tell that they don't have light and as well as they don't have generator. So when you go, they have to take some. That's why I did my shape without cutting down the hair because of the doom saw. So I think it is affecting some people over there.
So those are some Ghanaians sharing their experiences with us. Clearly, it's a time that many are not comfortable with. But the Public Utilities Regulatory Commission, PURC, is expected to meet the ECG. In fact, they did say that it will meet them today to insist for the provision of a timetable for consumers, so they can look at this plan and decide for themselves how they will go about their day and also plan their lives appropriately, plus their businesses. Well, still on power-related issues, the ECG announced, as you may know, the new subsidies introduced by government for the next 6 months. This is supposed to provide some form of relief from the high electricity tariffs suffered by Ghanaians in the past 4 months. But the big question is, how will I be able to see these differences when I pick up my meter or when I go to buy credit at a vending point? That's the question that the head of tariffs, Beatrice Adu, my colleague, asked of the head of tariffs at the ECG, Ebenezer Baden.
You can't put a number to, or an average number to it. What we say is that if you are 0 units, there is a gain for you. If you are 50 units, there is a gain. If you are 100 units, there is a gain. So that's why we are guiding customers with a reckoner. Now the reckoner will come to explain, for example, will calculate each unit of consumption, what it was before and then what it is now.
So would you say that the non-residential areas would be, as in for the industries, would have more subsidies to enjoy as compared to the residents?
No. What it is that it was apportioned pro rata to these customers. So industry has its share, residential customers also have their share. Remember, in terms of population, residential customers are more. So that's how it's prorated.
Now, the statement that was read to us, which came from government, said that this decision was arrived at after extensive consultations with all the stakeholders. And I want to find out from you, how sustainable is this?
Okay, so the word extensive in there meant that they have also determined how it will be paid for. And that brings in the sustainability part. If you give a subsidy and you don't know how it will be paid for, that's the question. But really, if the subsidy comes and then there is a clear mechanism to pay for it, then really sustainability requirements are met.
Are you not worried that over the years people have complained about how subsidies don't help the tariffs and the fact that consumers end up paying the same thing or the real tariffs at the end of the day?
Okay, so you see, sometimes subsidies come through pressure groups and all that. Perhaps once these decisions are being made, the mechanism hasn't been put together to identify how it will be paid for. It will have to go through budgetary mechanisms and all that. But once you identify, for example, I can give a very easy example. If, for example, the gas price of today is to be reduced, it means generation costs have gone down. And it's a way where subsidies can be obtained from. So there are so many ways of doing this. And then the consultation had to brainstorm and then come up with a mechanism for this to be addressed.
What would you say to those who would say that government owes you a lot of money, and instead of giving subsidies to consumers, why won't government pay your debt so that ECG will be efficient for everybody?
Okay, so this subsidy or relief we are talking about, the mechanism doesn't come on the government space. So there are two different type of arrangements that government is dishing it out from its space to support the customer. Now this mechanism is from a sector refinancing arrangement.
Which is where?
We're working towards that, and then we'll get you the details. I'm not empowered to speak on that today.
That's interesting. That has not been approved yet the implement approved.
And the clear mechanism or the process is being laid out. Yeah.
There are others who would say that this probably announcement is because the president announced it last month at during his Accounting to the People tour, that from the 1st of July they were going, the stakeholders were going to look at the billing system. What would you say to those who are saying this is some sort of pressure on you to do this, not necessarily because there ought to be something done about this?
So ECG didn't announce this on its own. We said the government of Ghana has given relief. So to begin with, it's not even coming from ECG. But we are the implementing agency, so we're implementing what has been given to the customer. And then we would have even decided to be quiet about it. But the customer goes to vent and he will see the reduction. So it's worth explaining to the customer that this is what has happened. And therefore, this press release.
Finally, do we know how long this subsidy system is going to work for?
The relief we are talking
about. The relief. How long is it going to be in the system?
I'm not too sure of that. But what it is that ECG has identified from between now and December, because normally we do planning, annual type of planning. So at the planning year or financial year, we know how much that is involved. And that has been used in the mechanism for its repayments.
You're saying that between now and December, and obviously there is an election on November 7. What would you say to those who say that, well, this could be a ploy by government to get people to think that they are doing something for Ghanaians?
Okay, so...
And using the ECG as a tool to implement it?
Okay, so if you talk about elections and all that, then really we are not talking about ECG operations anymore. I'm looking at the financial year. So from now till the end of the year, how much would that cost me as a business? And that's what I've put out there.
That's the head of tariffs at the ECG, Mr. Ebenezer Bini, speaking to my colleague Beatrice Edu. So the key question about how you will see it reflect in your bills, we still don't have a clear answer to it. He talks of a reckoner that will come out in the coming days. But we've heard from some industry players and those who know how exactly these subsidies work, someone like Dr. Charles Okudrobe of GIPO, boss of the VRA, saying that, look, if you look at the computation and the amount of money that will be spent here, you are talking some 1 cedi 50 pesos per month if you pick up that bill and you look at it closely. So the big question is, how does this really ease the kind of burdens that people are seeing with the killer tariffs that they call it, of how much they are paying for their power these days? We will interrogate this some more in the coming days, where we are not done with it. We'll still press on and get the answers for you here on the program. But later on, still on energy, we'll talk about some proposals coming in from some energy think tanks, talking about the justification for why the ECG should be privatized. They talk of inefficiencies in the service and the poor quality that we are getting today. We'll look at that in the course of the show here on The Pulse. But let's move to some other issues. And remember that we did some investigative work and brought it to you here from the St. Dominic Hospital. Today we're learning that 4 top officials of that hospital at Akwetia in the Eastern Region, who have been interdicted, have launched a fight back of our reports that the backdated salaries of 36 staff on government payroll. The Controller and Accountant General had been paying about 36 workers at least 8 months ahead of their start date. Some of the staff received some 15,000 Ghana cedis even before they started working in the hospital. Head of Finance at the hospital, Yao Pokuje, is one of those interdicted. He joins me in the studio to try and get an understanding of what actually happened and how come they were able to take these amounts of money and pay people who are not even reported for work. Thank you, sir, for joining us this afternoon.
Thank you
for spending time with us. So you got the notice of your interdiction when?
That was received on June 7th.
June 7.
Yes.
And what were the details of this interdiction?
The interdiction, in fact, query was given to me to respond to. I responded to the query, and then it was sent to the Diocesan Health Service Board. And following the query, the interdiction came.
Okay. Now, many of us don't know how things work in the hospital. You are the head of finance.
Yes.
How come you are paying people when they are not started work?
Thank you very much. I think that before I proceed on to answer your question, let me give you a brief background about how the whole issue came about. We received newly posted staff, around about 36, to the hospital from CHAG. So when they came,
CHAG being the
Christian Health Association of Ghana.
Okay.
Yes, because they had financial clearance and they were posted to us to come and commence work. These staff were processed onto controller and accountant general payroll. So the human resource unit did the processing of the 36. We processed them all right per the dates that were assigned to it. Some were supposed to report on the 1st of January 2015, especially for those staff that
2015 or 2016?
2015, 1st January. That is for those staff that are already in employment 2-3 years back.
Okay.
Because we have applied clearance for them, they say that the effective date should start from 1st January 2015.
Mm-hmm.
And then we had other staff that were supposed to start on 1st August. That is a newly posted staff. They were supposed to start in 1st August 2015. So we processed them with those dates. About 7 of those staff did not report on the exact date.
Of which one? The 1st August one, 2015?
Yes, the 1st August.
Mm-hmm.
They ascribed reasons to be lack of accommodation and other issues. They could not get a place to stay. So in August, when they came to fill the controller and accountant general input forms, they went back struggling for accommodation. So it was in September that they actually reported for work. This means that for the month of August, you didn't work.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, the salary that will be paid to you in August is an unearned salary, which will have to be returned to government chest. This is backed by the Financial Administration Regulation Act. That is section 12, subsection 2. That any unearned salary should go back to government chest. This is exactly what I was implementing. And then there are other staff that started on 1st January 2015. Those staff were staff that were supposed to be in employment a long time. But I had 3 people that also that same date were used for them as old staff, but they actually reported in August. This, I would say, was a genuine error from the HR unit. So I am the validating officer of the payroll. First, I am not the appointing authority. Head of finance, I do not issue appointment letters, so
yeah.
I cannot backdate appointment letters of staff. I validate the payroll. I have 353 staff on the government payroll. So every month I have to validate all of them. I do this with vigilance. So when I was going through the payroll in attempt of validating them, in March 2016, Controller Accountant General paid the salary and the arrears of these staff. I detected that, yes, they have paid per the month that they were mechanized. That is from 1st August,
mm-hmm.
and they reported in September. I quickly issued a letter to them to make refund of those on earned salary, because at that month they were not at post, back to Controller Accountant General, back to government chest. And then those that actually had their date started on 1st January 2015 too, I issued them with the same letter, giving them details of the account number that they were supposed to refund the money to. I have a copy of the letter that was issued to them.
Mm-hmm.
This is a copy. If you could remember the first publication that came online, there was a letter that was attached to that publication mm-hmm. online. It had a name typed, and then the list letter was pasted there.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, this was the letter directing them to refund that portion of their unearned salary to government chest. So this is exactly what I did as the head of finance to ensure that the government purse is protected. And this is my core responsibility. This is what I did. I gave them a clear deadline when they were supposed to refund the money, else I will place embargo on their salaries. They refused to do so, and accordingly, I placed embargoes on their salaries. In fact, my insistence to compel these staff to comply with this directive, it really infuriated them. One of them, the affected staff, argued that she was not going to refund because he didn't see the need to make that refund. I said no, on the grounds that one, she has colleagues in other facilities that have been given access to those monies. Two, the account number provided on this letter was fictitious, and my personal account.
Okay. Sorry, let me just take you back a bit, because
yes.
with all the things you said, it's your explanation from point the day that you started coming in up until now. But one thing I need to clear out here.
Yes.
People were paid as much as 15,000 Ghana cedis as back pay.
Yes.
Who is it that these people had not been paid up until that moment when they were paid for a period where they were not working or what? I don't understand that.
When you mechanize staff on Controller Akante, they do not immediately pay. Sometimes it takes some months.
How many
sometimes
months, usually?
It's not exact, it's not specific. Sometimes six, sometimes eight, sometimes five. It takes a very long time for Controller Akante General to pay. But when they are paying, they pay with arrears.
Mm-hmm.
So these staff, they were paid actually the arrears in March 2016. But the effective date was from January 2015. So we were paid from January 2015 to March 2016. And out of this period, from January to August, that particular staff was not at post. So that particular portion of the of that amount that was paid is deemed to be an unearned salary, which should go back to government chest.
Okay.
So it was, if you read the content of this letter, you would see that I have clearly stated that from this period, from 1st January 2015 to August 2015, you were actually not at post, and therefore this amount of salary you are not entitled to.
Okay.
Yes.
So when the notice came for you to be interdicted, it was on the knowledge that you had done what exactly?
That is what now I can substantiate. The memo, I received a query, and then on the interdiction, in fact, my lawyers have asked me to petition to a more higher body. I have written a petition to the higher body, and then we are waiting for a response.
Which higher body?
The higher body is the Catholic Bishop of Kofu Diocese, who is the owner of the facility.
Okay.
Yes.
And he's the one who appointed you to work there?
Exactly.
But again, if you're talking backdating and the controller comes in here, it means that there's a certain blend between the whoever appointed you and government. Because these people also work on government's payroll, isn't it? See,
we have the Diocesan Health Board, and then we have the management team. I'm part of the management team. As the head of finance, I give advice on to the hospital on the finances of the hospital. We will do the appointment locally. For senior staff, we will do the appointment. The diocese will come in and issue the appointment letters for senior staff. The other staff, sometimes we do it locally. But when we engage staff, we, because it takes a longer time for controller accountant general, what we do is that we issued, we give them salary advance, so that when controller accountant general pays, then they pay back the hospital whatever salary advance that has been given to them.
Okay. Yes. Now, you mentioned that there were some three individuals who had worked from the January up until the August period, but it was an error on the part of the human resource department.
Yes.
So the back pay they were given, they were due, isn't it?
No, they were not due. You see, the FAR is very clear and specific on it. Unless you actually worked for it, you see, the financial administration regulation, the financial administration regulation states that if even you made an error, if you take an illegal financial advantage of that error, that becomes financial misappropriation.
Mm-hmm.
But where you institute measures to rectify it, then it is clearly seen that this was not deliberate, and therefore it has to be corrected. And this, it happens everywhere. And when it happens, even when you are even preparing your own financial reports, there are times some figures you may understate, some figures you may overstate. But where you take illegal financial advantage of that situation, then it will be deemed as financial misappropriation.
Because the allegations coming from those who got these backdated salaries is that you had already paid them, this back pay came, some benefited, they also wanted to benefit. So how come they were being singled out to say that, you know, they are the ones who got it wrong?
No, no, that is not true. You see, we process them from a date. Those that started at the exact date, those that assumed that duty on the exact date, on the clearance date, nobody compelled them to refund anything, with the exception of those who took salary advance from the hospital and the controller accountant general paid their salaries.
Mm-hmm.
They were the people that are instructed that, okay, we have paid you this amount, controller has paid, so you have to refund that money back to the hospital. With this,
Are those the ones who said they will not pay?
No, the ones that are saying they will not pay are those that had did not report for work per the date that they were actually supposed to resume. For instance, some reported in August, but they were actually paid from January to July, which means that for that period they were not at post. That money is on earned salary, because the salary has been paid from January to March, and it was actually in March that controller accountant general paid the salary and the arrears. But you are actually not at post from January to August. So why do you benefit from that money?
Okay,
it's an earned salary.
Fine, I get that point. So now that you have been interdicted,
yes.
You say that your lawyers have advised you to take this matter up to a higher body. Are you not rather considering contesting this decision in the courts so that for the fact that you've been named in the matter at least and interdicted, you can clear your name beyond just going to a higher body?
Very good. That is why the first step was to appeal for the interdiction, that it was wrongful. That's why I've given it to a more higher body. They will look at the issue and can also look at how I also acted in this instance and see whether actually, whether I should be rather annulled or priest or be interdicted. So this is the first step. I'm only looking for out from their response. If I had to also come out, they again argue that the account number that I have provided was what? Was fictitious, and my personal account, in which I have asked them to go and pay the account inside. Some of the staff have complied with the instruction, and I've actually gone to pay the unearned salary.
So what? You asked them to pay the money into your account?
No.
For onward transfer into the bank account?
No. Straight, that is the bank details that is there in the letter.
Mm-hmm.
Straight to Controller Accountant General's suspense account. In this account, that is where all unearned salaries will have to be paid to. So it is clearly stated in their letter. This was an attempt to frustrate me, just to let me rescind my decision of asking them to refund. I stand by my principles. What is not right, I will not do.
Okay. Yes. So if you do not get a suitable response from this higher body you speak of, then what?
Obviously, I resort to the court for the issue to be addressed. Yes.
Is this something that happens all the time within the service?
You see, it happens almost every time. But the errors does not keep on reoccurring like that. This group, there were many. That's what I would say. So the HR unit will prepare the inputs and it will go to the association who issued the appointment letters. It doesn't happen regularly, but there are most of the times that we have to return salaries to CHESS in terms of resignation. When a staff resigns, immediately the salary doesn't go off the payroll. So whatever money that comes onwards, you have to return to CHESS.
Tell me something. You are head of finance, so yes. You'll be in the best position to tell me briefly. Do you know of people like you in positions like this who take full advantage of these kind of loopholes?
Very well, I have not. I don't know. I can't really tell for a fact. But looking at how this issue is handled, anybody who encounters similar issue like me may decide to give a blind eye to it, because that person may feel that you'll be subjected to that public ridicule like as is being meted to me.
Mm.
So we should be very careful how this issue is being handled, because it has the tendency of perpetuating a corruption. Because if I'm not vindicated by this action that I've taken, and I'm rather condemned for taking the rightful decision, any facility or any accountant in any other facility that finds himself or herself in this similar situation will recoil.
Okay.
Can give a blind eye to this.
Okay. Thank you, sir, for joining us this afternoon. I'm sure that for many who've listened to you, your position has been clearly stated. We'll see how it goes and how far you get with this particular case. He is Yao Opokweje, one of the four who've been interdicted after some investigations were done at the St. Dominic Hospital in Akwetia in the Eastern Region. The allegation is that some backdated salaries were paid 8 months. In fact, some got as many as 15,000 Ghana cedis paid into their accounts. The head of finance makes us understand that he asked them to refund monies that they are not earned and not worked for. And that's how come he's been caught in this web. But we'll see how this plays out in the coming days. So we'll go for a quick break at this point. We'll come back. We'll do some politics here on The Pulse. Stay with us. You're welcome back to The Pulse on your election headquarters, the Joy News Channel on Multi TV. We can now talk about some news coming in from the MPP. The opposition MPP has asked its members not to resort to politics of insult in their quest to criticize the ills of society. The party has come under criticism following its failure to take action against the Member of Parliament for Asin Central, Kennedy Ejepong. Several human rights activists have asked the lawmaker to apologize for those comments and have also implored the NPP to openly condemn the act. Here's the Acting General Secretary John Boyd, who's speaking to Joy News after making a donation to some headquarters today.
I and the New Patriotic Party believe that we can go about our politics in a decorous manner. We will not encourage any of our members to attack personalities. One, we believe that if there is a need to criticize, you can criticize constructively. And the electoral commissioner or any other state institution is not an exception. You understand? If you sometimes are not careful, the way the electoral commission is behaving, it looks like they are biased, really. So it leaves no doubt that people want to criticize the way they do. So I'm not condemning any statement. I'm not supporting any statement. I'm saying that we all, as a people, must go about our politics with decorum, and that's all. I think that he could have said it better. But all of us are not the same, you understand? And it's not like the New Patriotic Party in support of any statement that attacks women or attacks, not just women, men or everybody, you know, Ghanaian or foreigners, or we are not encouraging that. And we believe that we can do better by hitting strongly about things that are not. It depends on how it is condemned. It depends on who is saying what, you understand? Because if the NDC, who love beating women, you understand? For instance, what they did to Eslohusu, they've never felt remorse about it. Then all of a sudden, they are the ones shouting at rooftops. We think that there's some semblance of hypocrisy in their shouts. And I don't think it is wrong for anybody to raise that concern. That's all that I'm talking about. And from the discussion we've had, I've told you that the New Patriotic Party does not support any indecent language. We does not support personal attacks, be it a woman or a man.
So, listening to John Buedo, the indication is that they will not condone such acts in the future. But the question is, are they condemning the words of Kennedy Ejiofor today as he spoke against the EC chair, Charlotte Osei? That we're yet to find out. And remember that this issue has drawn a lot of attention from civil society groups, from women's groups, gender advocates, government officials, other political party actors also asking first for the party to openly condemn his acts and put out some punitive measures against him, so we don't see this happen in the future. Well, you have to see that happen, but we will see how this plays out in the days to come. But we will still stay with the NPP for a while longer, because the flag bearer of that party, Nana Akufo-Addo, is still touring. He is back in the crowd, but specifically at Medina. Let's get an update from journalist Latif Idris, who's following the NPP flag bearer. Latif, where's Nana Addo been to in Medina, and what has he been talking about today?
Yeah, Francis, Nana Addo, like you rightly pointed out, is in Medina right now. About 5 minutes ago, he just finished interacting with the imam and then the traditional authorities in his constituency. As I see Nana Addo stepping out of the meeting together with the party parliamentary candidate, that is Honorable Al-Haji. I'm sorry if I hear the tears by party people who are gathered there in their numbers, hearing Nana Addo as he steps out of the meeting with the traditional authorities, particularly in the Sunday community. So, Francis, that is the situation right here in the Medina constituency. Now, from here, Nana Addo is expected to move to the Pantanan Palace, where he's also expected to interact with the traditional authorities and the chiefs of that area. The next port of call, Francis, would be the Medina market, where it's also expected to interact with market women and traders in the area. The final place, as part of the tour in the Medina constituency, might be to interact with activists here in the constituency. So, if you ask me, that is the plan for the tour in the Medina constituency.
All right, thank you, Latif. I'm sure we'll revert sometime later and get an update on what exactly he's been talking about in this area. Remember that he's been busy. He was in the Eastern region just before the weekend, talking about the need for Ghanaians to vote for him in this year's election. We'll see what else his message will be in the days to come. But one other issue that we're keeping a close eye on today is that critical matter to do with the Supreme Court. They are set to give clarity on that issue relating to the individuals who registered with the NHIS cards. We're learning that the court is just about to give its clarity determination on that matter in just a moment. We'll bring an update on that from the Supreme Court right here on The Pulse in just a moment. Right then, now in less than 24 hours, Muslims all across the world will celebrate Eid al-Fitr to mark the end of the 30-day fast Ramadan. In a chat, we're joining Susan Mefa and Wenama Tiamo Eli about how they made it through the spiritual month in apparent readiness for the climax. A Muslim crusader, Jafar Muhammad, indicated that those who for no reason refuse to fast may face the wrath of God. But others who managed to complete the spiritual exercise also admitted that though it was difficult, it has been fulfilling.
It's been 30 days of fasting across the globe for Muslims. Here in Ghana, I'm in a Muslim-dominated community, which is Sinema. Residents here are feverishly getting ready for the celebration of Eid al-Fitr, which will be used to crown the 30 days of fasting. I'll be getting close to some of them to give us some personal experiences during those 30 days of fasting and how much they have been yearning for the end of this fast. Let's go. Today marks the end of the fast. How has it been since the beginning?
Okay, it was normal because we are having the short day and short night. Okay. So we weren't feeling any bad of experience, any something bad that I think it happens 2 years ago. Mm. It's like we did it normally without feeling any bad experiences, without experiencing any bad things.
Bad things like what? Like, give an example.
Okay, for me, I will use myself for example. Last 2 years, I couldn't be able to complete the 30 because whenever I get to 28, 27, then I fall sick.
Oh, okay. So this time around, you've gone through the 30 days.
Yes.
Fatih is really prepared for the salah. You can see on her hands, she's already started designing her hands with a lily. It's a traditional way of celebrating the Ramadan, the festival. And for women like her, things of this nature are very important. In fact, these are some of the things that sets you out, that makes you look special. So she's really ready.
For those who fail to participate in the 30 days fast, they will face the wrath of God. This is the take of an Islamic crusader, Jafar Muhammad. He explained that Ramadan is a command by God and Muslims are obliged to obey except for those who have genuine reasons.
It is as if the person has challenged the authority of God by not abiding by what the Almighty God has mandated for everyone to follow. You know, it's just as if, that not even as if, the person has completely failed to go by what the Almighty God has said. And then besides also, when we, physically also, the person is going to lose a lot because this Ramadan is something like, I could say, a very big treatment for the body.
Having gone through the 30-day spiritual exercise, Ramatu describes her experience as very difficult but fulfilling. She's been sharing some of those difficult moments with Joy News.
As for me, for the 30 days, sometimes I've been feeling hungry because
it's difficult.
It's very difficult because when the sun is shining,
then your stomach is
aching.
Okay,
so
what do you do when you begin to feel that way?
Sometimes I actually sleep, and sometimes too I keep my hunger.
You keep your hunger. So I'm sure you would have grown lean, or you'd have grown weak. Sometimes you feel as if you are sick.
Yeah, I feel as if my head is aching me, and sometimes too I feel tired.
Has anything changed about you?
Not yeah.
What exactly?
I'm slim.
You are slim.
Yeah.
Before you were fat. Sorry, you were plump. You were heavy.
Yeah, I was heavy small, but now I even feel pity for myself.
And that's an achievement.
Yes, because tomorrow the dress I'm going to wear, I know that it will fit me. Because how I am to like this.
So if the dress will not fit you, then it means that you will not feel confident inside. You will not feel good about yourself.
I'll feel confident because my sister is a seamstress. If it doesn't fit me like this, I can go and give it to her. Okay. And she will do it for me.
Okay, so I have mother. Mother too will be sharing her experience. Mother, how many days have you been able to do the fast?
I did it only for 26 days.
Mm-hmm. Why 26 days?
Because I was in my menses, so I have to stop. Since I'm in my menses, it means I'm not pure for the fasting, so I just break.
Okay.
So what happens to the rest of the 4 days?
In the 4 days, after the salad, I leave it till maybe 1 month later, then I'll pay for the four.
You pay? How do you pay?
It's the same way as we do in this Ramadan. I'll just wake up at dawn, eat, and then pray and all those things for 4 days.
So you fast for 4 days?
Yes.
Is that what the Quran says you should do?
Yes.
If you don't, is it mandatory or is optional?
It's mandatory. Since I'm healthy, then I know I can do it. I have to do it.
How do I know you have done it or you haven't done it?
And that depends on me. Since I'm the one doing the fasting, and I know that if I'm in my menses, I can't do the fasting. I have to stop. So those in my room too know that maybe I've not, maybe for 4 days now, I've not been able to do the fasting. So after the salah, maybe about 1 month time, then I'll pay.
Aisha has stomach ulcer, so she's unable to fast. She tells Joy News she's required to choose someone to fast on her behalf. She says this will enable her to be equally blessed.
I started fasting at the age of 12.
Okay.
That's, I do it from morning to 12. So it's something that I would love to do.
Mm-hmm.
But because of my stomach ulcer, so I'm not able to be doing it.
Do you feel excluded in this exercise in any way?
No, I don't.
Okay.
Because what they do whilst fasting, I make sure I do the same.
Which are?
Reciting the Quran and let us be. I make sure I do the same thing as they are doing. Mm-hmm. So I don't feel excluded. Mm-hmm. Not at all.
Mm-hmm. But is it true that those of you who are unable to fast during the period, you could do that later? Is there anything like that?
It depends. If you know you can do it later on, but it's not advisable. What's advisable for you to do is to feed someone who is in need. Give the person what the person will eat at dawn. And iftar time, that's 6, when it's about to break the fast.
Even if you are not fasting personally.
Yeah.
You should ensure that you feed the hungry.
To enable that person to fast.
Okay.
And if you can't feed the person, you give the person money that you will eat. That will be enough for you at dawn and iftar.
Okay.
So you give
so
the
is
person.
Is it to say that the person is fasting on your behalf?
Yeah. You get the same blessing as the person is doing.
Okay.
And that too, it has to be someone who has iman. Someone that is,
what does that mean?
Faith.
Okay.
Someone that you know that the person is fasting, the person is doing what you will do, not like you will do per se. The person, when I see someone is having faith, you understand.
Yes, I do. Okay.
Yeah.
So in your case, do you have somebody to fast on your behalf?
Yeah.
So you have been giving the person giving food and money.
Yeah.
Who is this person?
I can't say it.
It's not allowed to disclose the person.
No, it's not. It's not allowed, cause it even says in your Bible that if you do something with your right hand, your left hand shouldn't know.
Okay.
So
this is between you and the one who is fasting on your
behalf. Yeah, and Almighty Allah.
Okay. So you give the person food?
No, not food per se, because I've been going to work. Okay. So in the morning or maybe when it's 6, I give the person money.
Oh, okay.
And you can, maybe you, it's not only one person. If you have, you can give more than 2 or 3. But for my case, I give only one person.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And how has the person fed others well?
Like,
has the person been able to go through the Sheikh Saeed Dahman is one of the malams in the Zabarma community in Nima. According to him, Ramadan was prescribed by Prophet Muhammad. He believes that even eating at dawn prior to the start of the exercise comes with a blessing, and Muslims must respect these provisions associated with the fast.
The reason is from our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, told us to show us to take a food that time. But if you take the food, it will help you to continue your fasting. But if you didn't take it before, at times, maybe the thing will disturb you. Because of that, he says, we have to take our food that time. But if some people, they decide to take it early. Taking it early, there's no problem. But take it that time, around 3 to 4 is better, according to the teaching of Prophet Muhammad. Yeah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Thank you.
Pretty interesting piece there, put together by my colleague MFA Tiamua Eli, bringing us that report from Nima. And we will interrogate this particular issue with Ramadan and all the intricacies that you may not be aware of. We'll delve into it some more here on the program. But there are some news coming in that I just want to draw your attention to, because the Chief Justice has summoned the owner of Munti FM and three others who were part of a radio discussion where a panel member threatened to kill some Supreme Court judges. The three are host Sally Fumase, Alistair Nelson, and Akko Gunn to appear before it to show cause why they should not be punished for making inflammatory comments against the court. They are yet to deliver the ruling on the matter, the substantive matter on the voters register, but this is what we are gleaning from the Supreme Court this afternoon. The Chief Justice has asked that the owner of Munti FM be made to appear before the court to answer for those radio discussions that went on, in which suggestions were made about threats against the lives of some judges in the country today. We'll bring you more on that story as and when we have the full details for you. And also an update from the Supreme Court on the clarity that's supposed to be given on the NHIS card registrants into Ghana's voters register. But let's now delve a bit more into the Ramadan that's ending today. 30 days of fast. The Muslims have been abiding with this principle. It's a very solemn moment for them. In fact, I have friends that even if I want to greet and shake their hands, they say, look, the personal contact, we cannot have too much of it in these times because we are in a very spiritual exercise. We do not need to do things like we do ordinarily. Well, joining us in the studio this afternoon, we are gracious to have the national spokesperson for the National Chief Imam, Sheikh Arimaya Shaibu, joining us. Thank you, sir, for joining us here on the program.
Thank you for the opportunity.
There are so many questions, and for those who are not Muslims, it's the perfect time to give us a bit of education so we get to understand the intricacies of what you do. For someone who sits back and looks at what you do, Ramadan, a 30-day fast, yes, but why do you have to, because there are some who ask questions, why do you have to eat at dawn and still say you're fasting for 12 hours?
Thank you very much for the opportunity. The first answer I want to give you is that the Islamic concept of fasting, as opposed to some other forms of fasting, does not suggest self-abnegation and self-annihilation. What it means is that fasting is a state of worship in which one abstains from eating within certain hours of the day. Those hours within which he abstains from eating and other pleasures of the flesh is what gives him the opportunity to connect with his spiritual self and to connect with God. And that's why the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, who teaches us what fasting, in fact, he makes a statement that gives us a new definition of fasting. Literally, for those who traditionally, people think fasting means just abstaining from eating, drinking, sex. Then the Prophet makes a statement that many times people fast and yet do not gain anything from their fasting except empty thirst and empty hunger. In another tradition, he says, whoever fasts and does not eschew or abandon falsehood and acting on sin, then God is not in need of his abstention from eating and drinking.
Okay. So there are conditions for
exactly.
the fasting.
So therefore, then this gives you a certain broad meaning of fasting. So fasting, in the first place, is an activity of the mind, activity of the spirit, and activity of the body. If anyone fasts and he's unable to connect these three, he will not be able to fulfill God's wisdom in making fasting promulgatory on us.
Okay.
Now, the popular text of the Holy Quran, which almost every scholar would make reference to indicate what purpose are we expected to fulfill. It's Quran chapter 2, verse 183. That fasting, all you who believe, fasting has been made obligatory on you as it was made obligatory on nations that came before you, that you may attain piety. Or if what various interpretations, the word used there is taqwa, la'allakum tattaqun, that you may attain piety or God consciousness or God-mindedness, or the fear of God. In other words, unequivocally, God has made clearly to us his reason why he wanted us to fast. if you fast for 1 month and by own measure or calibration, whatever you want to use, you are unable to determine to tell yourself that you have fulfilled God's purpose, that is when you have not fasted. And that's why the prophet says that many times people fast
and get nothing out of it
except empty thirst and empty hunger.
That's great. But I should say at this point that it's not an easy thing to go 30 days, 12 hours every day, denying your body food. It must be a tough thing, and I want to congratulate many of you and many out there around the world who have been able to go through this process successfully. But are there limitations for people's professions who are Muslims and the ability to or not to do the fasting?
One of the beautiful things about the Sharia, which the source from which we derive the rules guiding our the conduct of our fasting, is that it is flexible and moderate.
Okay.
Now, manifestation of that flexibility on moderation is what brings about the exemption. There are two forms of exemptions. We have what we call the temporary exemption and the permanent exemption. In other words, when you are in a certain condition of sickness, if that sickness is chronic and it weakens you so debilitating that in that condition there's no way you can fast, or a doctor has prescribed for you not to fast because of your chronic condition, In that circumstance, permanently you are exempt from fasting. But that what you can do to also have an experience of the moment and to get the blessing is that you do a certain kind of sacrifice by giving a charity of food that you give to a needy who is close to you.
Okay.
Just that, in place of each day of fasting, you give a certain feeding. But if it is a temporary condition in which we are hoping that you get healed, what you do is that for the days that you are unable to fast, you pay for those days when Ramadan has ended. In the subsequent months, you have an opportunity, there's no compulsion to follow immediately. Mm-hmm. In fact, between one Ramadan season and another, you have a stretch of period in which you select when you want to, at your own pace,
do it.
You select a day. And then you do it.
I ask the question based on profession because I've heard people say that some footballers, for instance, are unable to do it. Mm. Because if you look at the regimen they go through every single day, the training they go through, the exposure to the sun, the very difficult challenges they have in soccer, it's tough for them to do it. Is there a specific exemption for them?
Still the flexibility and a place out. Depending on the condition and experience of the individual. In fact, there are those who can even become stronger when they fast, regardless of the strenuous exercise they go through. Mm-hmm. Because fasting is a spiritual exercise. Your strength derives so much from your spirit. Mm-hmm. And so they derive more of the spiritual energy that translates into their physical energy. And so they are able to fast even under the situation of fasting when they are in hunger. So it depends on the individual. So we have individuals who fast and they're able to play their football. But that if that is your profession, and without it you cannot survive, that is the only profession you have, and under this condition you are unable to fast, Islam will allow you to break the fast, and then you make up for other days when you are out of season. It is permitted.
Okay.
Because you yourself have chosen to do it, in that particular case, indeed, there are two things you will do. You will fast those number of days, and still you also, as an expiation, mm-hmm. you also feed
the others that you can.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, that's fine. One other thing, and it was mentioned in the report MFA did, for those ladies who are going through that time of the month, I'm wondering why they can't do it. Why not? Because it's not a chronic condition.
Right.
Why should they be exempt? Some will say it's a natural thing that happens for every woman.
It's a natural thing that happens, but the state itself, in Islamic view, is, you know, for Islam, any act of worship is guided by certain rules and regulations. In fact, there are what we call conditions for compulsion and conditions for validity. In other words, what is it that will make it compulsory for you to pray 5 times a day? One of them, that you must be a Muslim. Mm-hmm. So once you are not a Muslim, it's not mandatory on you to say that prayer. Fasting, for example, one of the conditions for compulsion is that you must be a Muslim. So for you, for example, close to me, if you are not a Muslim, by the condition of compulsion, you are exempt from fasting.
Exactly.
You cannot fast. Mm-hmm. So that is one condition. And then the other condition is condition for validity. What makes the fasting acceptable? you must be in a state of ritual purity. We have something called a ritual purity. That is why you find that when it's time for the Muslim to pray, and he has, excuse my language, he has urinated or he's visited the washroom, you need to go and wash himself and undergo what we call the ritual purity of ablution. You see it? Yeah. But because when the woman is in that state, she cannot wash herself because it's a continuum. That is why, because she's in a state of ritual impurity. So I'm using the word ritual impurity. Yeah, it is that ritual impurity that exempts her. Now, when she has completed her cycle, now she goes through what we call the ritual bathing to clean herself. Then after that, she begins to fast.
Okay.
Those days that she was not able to fast because of the condition, she makes up in the subsequent
for
months.
It. Yeah. One thing also that came up is about those who are Muslims who do not do the 30-day fast.
Yeah.
Could face the wrath of God. What kind of wrath would that be? I'm just wondering.
I think that sometimes some Muslim scholars are quick in passing judgment. You know, from my understanding, we have a God who is very compassionate. And invoking him, compassion and beneficence and munificence is three of his attributes that we use to invoke him. And I find that one to be a contradiction. When in default, as immediately, then you face the wrath of God. You see, wrath portends anger, portends the violence, the dimension of God.
Mm-hmm.
But in the way that God deals with us, he deals with us appreciating our infirmities. And so he gives us an opportunity to restore us into connection with him.
Okay.
So it is not good that we pass quick judgment for God. There must be a reason why the person, in fact, even under the temptation of Satan, God sees our shortcomings and he's prepared to forgive us. That is why he gives you the chance. He says that if you deliberately, he doesn't say you face the wrath of God. If you deliberately eat food during Ramadan, what you have done is that you have violated the sanctity of the month. The holiness of the month has been violated.
Mm-hmm.
And so therefore, what you do, one, is that you fast for 2 months consecutively.
Wow, that's the punishment.
Yeah, not a punishment, mm-hmm. a kind of expiation.
Okay.
You atone for your deliberate violation. So you are able to. Once you are an obedient servant and you are able to do so. Or you feed, 60 indigent or poor people.
Okay.
So you see, you have a choice.
One thing that comes up, and just to wrap up the conversation, some say that the 30-day fast is ending. There's a business side to all of this. That when you're done with the fast for the day, there's the availability of cocoa in almost every corner in Accra. Now you're not going to see more of it anymore.
Yeah.
What happens to that?
Oh, I think it's just kind of swapping. What most people would have used in the morning, now it is turned into the evening.
So it's reversing to normal.
So it's going to reverse. In the morning now, they have the gusto for food, and the cocoa is ready, and they'll go and buy. But what I must add is that, you see, the fasting season is not meant for us to voraciously eat food.
Some do, isn't it?
I think I want to educate Muslims.
Yeah.
And that's why I find it unimpressive that when we fast and we find politicians and other people chasing us with food. Because that is
what they do,
Yeah, oh yes, yes. Because that is when your eating attitude must change. Your moderation in eating. You eat less because the pleasures of the self is what you have cut. You see, there's a certain detachment, so that you can have a certain inner discipline.
So they should stop. The politicians should stop bringing it.
Oh yeah, I don't find it impressive. Yeah. I don't find it. You see, I want the politicians that they must see our priority needs. If you come to my community, and my community is poor, we have a school that has been ripped off. Come and give me iron sheets, iron roofing sheets. Give me cement so I can educate the children. Mm-hmm. Don't give me food. And I think sometimes for electoral gains, they deceive us. And I want to call off my elders that when such things come, they should be able to tell them that, look, my priority is cement, my school. My school is breaking down. My hospitals. We are unable to get children. 7-year-old child is dying, and our health facility will look on the boy to die because nobody is paying. It's painful. our sense of sacrifice should make us do something about this.
Rather than just bringing food.
Those food, they should take it to hospital. I will be more impressive if you tell me that, look, Chief Imam, we know you care for people, so we are giving, we know you send food to the hospitals, and we are making this donation so that you can take it to Kolebu, for very weak people who need food.
Yeah.
I'll be more impressed than to give me when I know this is a time when I eat less. You don't impress me.
Okay, all right. Thank you so much for joining us. Do you have any specific message, especially being the spokesperson for the Chief Imam, for the Muslims who are ending the fast today?
Really, there's a message, and Chief Imam has already given that message, and I speak on his behalf, particularly to our young ones. There is overindulgence in the celebration. And I think that we want to educate them to understand that our merrymaking and joyous moment does not permit us to engage in a risky way of celebrating and also endanger the lives of very innocent people who are in the community. We should not ride reckless motor riding, using the taxis, indecent dressing, and harassing people around. It doesn't show that we have changed, we have developed spiritually, we have emerged as new people. I don't think that we should do so. And the elections are coming. The lessons of Ramadan fasting, more tolerance, should guide us in the period leading up to the election, so that we can have a very peaceful election.
Okay. How do I do the greetings when you end the
Ramadan? Baraka de Salah.
Baraka de Salah.
Or you can say Eid Mubarak.
Okay. I think I like the Baraka. Baraka Salah.
Baraka Kadeh.
Baraka de Salah.
Baraka Kadeh.
Thank you very much for joining us this afternoon. The spokesperson for the National Chief Imam, Sheikh Aramiya Al-Shaibu, gracious enough to join us this afternoon for some education about the 30-day fast period for Muslims. And today is actually the end of that season. We wish them all the best. After the spiritual encounter in the 30 days, it will help them to be much better people in the country today. We will pause for sports here on the program. Stay with us. Right now, so that's it for today here on the Pulse on the Joy News channel on Multi TV. For more news, tell you where you should go, myjoyonline.com. That's where you find all the breaking news and trending stories. You will also get an update on what's happening in the courts. That story is at myjoyonline.com. Follow and get the details for yourself. Thank you so much for being a part of this show. My name is Francis Abba, and this show airs 3 to 5 p.m. right here on the Joy News channel on Multi TV. Thanks for your company. I'll see you sometime later.